So I would like to talk today to you about the complexity of analyzing tissue sections in the context of cancer and how technology may help. So we all know cancer is a very scary disease. Actually, it's a devastating disease, and there will be this year over 8 million people dying from cancer worldwide. And actually, there's a report from the National Cancer Institute in the USA that predicts that 1.6 million people this year alone will be diagnosed, will be new patients diagnosed with cancer. And one of the problems with cancer is that it's not one single disease, it's a very complex disease, it's a class of disease. It can affect different organs, it can even spread from an organ to another one. So, if a patient is suspected from having a cancerous tumor in the body, maybe the medical staff would like to have a small biopsy taken from the patient, and then they have to slice the biopsy in very thin tissue sections, a few micrometers thick, that they put on top of glass slides. And the job of the pathologist and his team is then to discover, to detect a number of so-called disease markers that might be present in the tissue section. So a disease marker might be a cancerous cell, it might be a protein, it might be a fragment of DNA. It's whatever biological entity that can be found in the tissue section and that relates to a very specific tumor. So the pathologist discovers those disease markers in the section, in the tissue section, by applying over all the section a chemical, a liquid containing a chemical that can react and color a specific disease marker. So they have a range of chemicals and apply them one after the other. And then the pathologist goes on a microscope and he looks for colored areas, dark spots, and colored cells. And he's then using his expertise, his judgment, and he's going to go back to the patient and the family with good news, bad news, or maybe even no answer. Maybe some more tests would be needed. So there's many studies actually looked at the difference between an initial diagnostic and a second opinion. So I'm glad you recognize this guy because some of the people in IBM had no idea of who he was. I think they watch me online, I have to be careful. But the key point there is, a second opinion is maybe a more experienced pathologist that will look at the initial diagnostics. And in about 18% of the cases, he will slightly disagree with the initial diagnostic. Now, those might be subtle differences that are not so important. But in 1 to 2% of the cases, the difference is absolutely dramatic. So for example, the pathologist providing a second opinion may say, wow, this patient was diagnosed with cancer, I completely disagree, there was no tumor. And the patient maybe had therapy or worse, surgery, maybe he had the prostate removed. So as a technologist, I'm stepping out a little bit from that. And I'm trying to think about what type of technology can I think of developing that maybe could address a number of questions, a number of problems, a number of headaches that the pathologists have. And clearly, I think that a key problem is biopsies are small samples. They cannot have a lot of tissue sections, and the tissue sections are not huge in area. And the second thing is that, you know, applying the chemicals and trying to stain, to color, and find the disease markers is a bit like cooking, right? It's not an absolute art. It's not digital science. So maybe I would like to make a technology that could help them to have a bit more quantitative information. Now let's speak about the volume and cost of reagents. So to give you an example, actually, the Clinical Pathology Institute of the University Hospital of Zurich, with whom we work, is using about 70 tons of liquids and chemicals for staining tissue sections per year. So that's about 200 liters a day. And actually, some of those chemicals are more expensive than gold. The last problem I can think of, but I have to say I'm not completely sure about this one, I can imagine that if a surgeon is taking care of a patient who is under anesthesia in the surgery room, Maybe the surgeon sees what looks like a tumor and he would like to send a sample for analysis and quickly know if he should remove it while the patient is under surgery anesthesia. I'm not fully sure if actual technology can deal with this problem or not. So then, recently, a bit more than a year, we came up with an idea, and that was that instead of applying a chemical to the entire tissue section, we'd like to shape liquids and provide chemicals locally, somewhere very precise, a precise location on a tissue section. And we developed a technology that we call the microfluidic probe. I'm going to explain you how it works. So now we have a glass slide. There would be on such a glass slide a tissue section, but it's not represented just for simplicity. And we fabricate micro devices, for, such as the one going down in close vicinity to the glass slide. And this device has a micro aperture, very small aperture, and we use it to inject a liquid containing the chemicals that we want to use to stain and find the disease markers on the surface. But we need to stop the video there, because actually if we proceed by injecting the liquid outside of the head, we are going to have a failure. We are working with extremely small quantities of chemicals and liquids, and there is air around. So if the liquid gets out, there will be a lot of evaporation. It's going to be a catastrophe. We then immerse the head with a few millimeters of just neutral solution, water, let's say. And now we can inject, so we take care of the evaporation problem, and we can inject our chemical and bombard the surface with it locally. But there's another very important bug here. If we continue injecting the liquid on top of the surface, we don't localize anything. There's no shaping of liquids. So we spread the chemical all over the place. So the key trick that we use is we add a second aperture. And the job of the second aperture is to aspirate some of the liquid around as well as the chemical that we inject locally. Now we are shaping liquids. Now we do something controlled and very local on a surface. So I actually can show you a real-time video how it looks like. So what we have here is the head scanning on top of a glass slide, and we can watch from underneath using a microscope. And the two bright squares are the apertures of this microfluidic device that you can see. And we can quickly deposit and write even patterns of chemicals on surfaces. And by the way, the dimension of those patterns are very small. They are a fraction of the diameter of a human hair. So we then moved on and did some more useful testings and applied this technology to actually scan real tissue sections. The sample you see on the background that looks a bit like cornflakes and so on is actually a human tissue section from a patient having breast cancer. And we are writing a line, we are moving the device along a line, and we have a green colored liquid, a liquid with chemicals that goes from one aperture to the other. Now, of course, it's not a perfect glass slide. I mean, there's a bit of topography, and the sample is challenging a little bit the shaping of the liquid and the localization. Nevertheless, we don't have catastrophes, and the liquid stays pretty well in contact where it should be with the surface. So with this, with this idea, we developed a platform, and we have this microfluidic probe head on XYZ computer control high precision motors. And we can, it's like a flight simulator. Basically, we have a joystick, we look into a microscope, and we can tell the head where to go on top of a surface. And the bottom right image is actually another breast tissue section from a patient having cancer. It's a very small one, it's just a few millimeters in diameter, actually. And you can see that we can stain specific cells making this type of inverted U shape, and there the cells are stained in blue. So there's something I think very important in having this shaping of liquids and local chemistry going on. Because now we can do something very useful. We can scan lines of tissue sections and vary the speed at which we move the probe. So let's imagine I'm the probe, I'm going to write a line of chemicals on a tissue section, that's the floor, the stage there is the tissue section. Now I go fast, If I go fast, I do not spend a lot of time depositing chemicals for staining. The staining contrast would be small, there would be a low contrast. But then, if I slow down, I'm going to spend much more time on the tissue section, really bombarding it with a lot of chemicals, and I'm going to push the contrast. I'll have a strong color at the end of the line. And I think this is very important because on one line, we have a large contrast, an optimal contrast that could help the pathologist to really recognize more easily if the disease marker is there or not. By the way, when I was doing that, just for the people in the back of the room, I was not explaining the moonwalk. Huh? I was describing million-dollar research on nanotechnology. This is an example where we can do multiplexing. Actually, multiplexing is easy. We take the probe, we scan a local area of a tissue section with chemical A, we move to another area, we change the chemical, we put chemical B. So on one tissue section, we can get more information than conventional techniques. So if I'm given, for example, a 1 cm² tissue section, with this technology, I could think of using only 5% of the area. And even within that 5%, I would be able to easily spot about to localize chemicals on 500 spots. Now, in terms of roadmap, we have a problem in the lab. We tend to be complicated people developing big, bulky, expensive platforms. So they are very powerful, but I think they're good for research. And actually, you need to be a smart student or a techno geek to use them. And recently, we repackaged those platforms into a 2 kg type of instrument that we can put on any kind of microscope. And the idea is to make this technology much more available for researchers in the life sciences. But I see the real bottleneck, the big challenge with this technology is actually to go from our lab to the clinics. So we really have to rethink it, to re-engineer the system, and kind of provide to the pathologist a big black box where medical staff could put a tissue section, press a button, and have an automated analysis. And I think that's a big challenge that we have right now. So I hope that with this short presentation, I was able to show you how shipping liquids and miniaturization may help to remove a number of headaches that the pathologists have. Thank you for your attention.